So in the last two videos, I went over the details of an out-of-order processor and I explained what happens in each one of these components. I'll just scan through the next few slides so that anyone that wants a recap can just read through these slides by pausing the video. All right, so now let me go back to that initial figure and let me expand on this design some more. Okay, so unfortunately, what I described last time, you know, that exact implementation is not how real processors are actually implemented. Okay, there is something different that they actually do, and I will go into those details in this video now. Okay, so the main reason why that earlier design was not implemented is because of how register values get copied across different places, right? So we said that when a result is produced, it first gets written into this temporary storage. When that instruction later commits, it copies the value from T1 into, you know, say R1. And at the same time, I have to go through my issue queue. I have to broadcast that change to the issue queue. And anyone that refers to T1, that name has to be changed so that they now refer to the new name, R1. Okay, and all of this represents something that is fairly complex. Okay, so for that reason, you know, this is not how real processors are implemented. The reason why I explained it this way is because, you know, this is conceptually easier to understand. Okay, so now that we've understood, you know, why we have temporary storage and why things get copied upon commit, let's look at an implementation that does not require this kind of copy. Okay, let me first clear this screen out. Okay, so, you know, what I essentially have in my earlier design is I have this set of 32 registers that are considered to be the permanent values, right? They represent the values of instructions that I've already committed. Okay, so they are usually referred to as logical registers or architected registers. Okay, that is, you know, these are the register names that the architecture defines. And so the compiler produces code that refers to these registers, right? So the compilers produce code that refers to, you know, R1, two registers, R1 through R32. These registers over here sitting in the reorder buffer are actually called rename registers. I'm using these registers to rename instructions, and I'm using them as temporary storage for instructions that are in flight, that is, instructions that have not yet committed. Okay, now I'm going to build a unified register file over here, which is called the physical register file. Okay, and it has, you know, two halves, let's say. You know, I'm just drawing this loose boundary line between the two. And let's say that the left half is my set of logical registers. Okay, and my right half, let's say, are my rename registers. Okay, so now, you know, let's assume that, you know, these registers are called, you know, P1, and let's say there are 64 of these, so, you know, P1 all the way to P64. And at first, let's say that, you know, the logical register R1 can be found in physical register P1 over here. Okay, and logical register R2 is found in P2 and so on. Now, when some instruction gets renamed over here, it's going to pick a register from this rename pool. Okay, let's say that this register is now P33. Okay, so now, you know, for this instruction, I'm going to put its temporary result in physical register P33. And so a result is produced, it gets written into P33. Now when that instruction commits, what I was previously doing is I was copying the value in P33 into P1. Now I won't do that anymore. Okay, I'm going to keep that value stuck in P33. What I'll instead do is I'll have a map table that says that the committed value of R1, which was previously in P1, is now in P33. Okay, so, you know, before I used to say that the committed value can be found here, now I'm going to change that and say that the committed value can be found in this register over here. Okay, and I don't do any copies, and I don't have to go and update the issue queue entries either. Okay, so, well, what ends up happening is P1, which used to be part of the set of logical registers, now becomes free, right? Now it's a register that I can use to put other values in, because no one is ever going to care about the value that used to be sitting in P1, okay? Because now if anyone wants to refer to R1, they're going to refer to the value sitting in P33, not the value in P1. So P1 contains garbage, and that now joins the list of free registers. That is, it can be used by other instructions for renaming. Okay, so it joins the list of rename registers. Okay, so this boundary that I designed earlier will keep changing. Okay, so now my logical registers becomes this collection over here. And over time, as other registers get renamed, you know, again, that boundary keeps shifting. So ultimately, my physical register file, you know, will contain a few logical registers, you know, sitting here. And then it'll contain a bunch of rename registers interspersed among them as well. Okay, so now let me make this description more concrete by looking at one specific example. Okay, let me move to this figure over here. Okay, and you'll see a few changes over here. I have a speculative register map table, which keeps track of the state of all instructions that have entered the pipeline. And then I have a committed register map table that represents the state of all instructions that have committed, that is, they have left the pipeline. Okay, I have a physical register file over here with, you know, P1 through P64. Okay, so there's no other temporary storage of register values. Let's again walk through this example. So here's an instruction which needs the values R1 and R2. So I'm just going to redraw the speculative map table over here to make things a little bit more clear. And, you know, I'll use this as an example as I step through these five instructions. So initially, you know, let's assume that R1 is placed in P1, R2 is placed in P2, R3 is placed in P3, and so on. Okay, all the way until R32. And similarly here for the committed map table, right? So R3 is mapped to P3, and so on. Okay, so this is at the start of the program, where I assume that the first 32 physical registers contain the contents of the 32 logical registers. Okay, so R1 through R32 are mapped to P1 through P32. Then when this instruction enters the pipeline, I look at my speculative map table. So this is my speculative map table, which I'm just kind of redrawing up over here. So I look at this table and I say, well, you know, where can I find the latest values of R1 and R2? Well, those are found in P1 and P2. So I correspondingly rename that instruction to get its input operand in P1 and P2. Then I have a set of rename registers, which start with, you know, P33, P34, P35. I'm just going to write a few, enough to keep me going through my example, until P64. Okay, so now, you know, I need some place to store the result of that first instruction. Okay, and I'm going to pick a free register from my rename pool, which is P33. So this gets removed from my free pool, and P33 becomes the destination of that register. Okay, so now my speculative map table has to keep track of every instruction that has entered the pipeline. Okay, so given everything I've seen so far, if I want the latest value of R1, I will now find the latest value of R1, not in P1, but in P33. So this is what the speculative map table keeps track of. Okay, it keeps track of every instruction that has entered the pipeline so far. Then I try renaming the second instruction. It needs the values in R1 and R3. The latest value of R1 is found in P33. Latest value of R3 is found in P3. So this instruction gets renamed to get its input operands from P33 and P3. It needs to put its result somewhere. So I take the next rename register from here, P34. And so that becomes my destination. And I have to change my speculative map table to say that the latest value of R2 can now be found in P34. Then the third instruction is a branch which does not need a destination register. It just needs to read the value in R2, which the speculative map table tells me can be found in P34. So it gets an input operand from P34. Then the next instruction, you know, needs values in R1, R2, which are now in P33 and P34, puts the destination in the next free register, which is P35. So that becomes the destination. And you update the map table to say that R3 can now be found in P35. Okay, then next instruction, which again renames R1. Okay, so I need the values in R3 and R2, refers to P35 and P34. Okay, and the destination is going to now get the next register from here, P36. So that's my destination. And I have to change my map table to say that the latest value of R1 is no longer in P33, it is now in P36. Okay, so at this point, I'm not going to put P33 back in the free pool, okay, because I actually still care about the value in P33, and this will be made clear shortly. Okay, so as of now, P33 is still alive. It's not being put back in my rename pool.